Today on Healthy is the New Skinny Live, we want to talk to you about a lot of really important things that we do in our work every day. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Katie Halchishick again, and I created Healthy is the New Skinny to really address a lot of things that go on in the fashion industry when it comes to body image and how women and girls are affected by this every day. So we have a lot of exciting content, and together I really think that by talking about these issues, we can have solutions to help ourselves heal as we're helping other girls to heal. So today we have our experts that we can't wait to introduce you to. We have a whole panel of models who are ready to dish the dirt when it comes to body image, Photoshop, and the fashion industry. So you can ask them any questions you want. We're going to have an open forum. And first, I want to introduce you to our chat host, Danica Breisha.
Hi guys, I'm Danica, and thank you so much for joining us today with emPOWerme TV. I'm here on behalf of Healthy is the New Skinny and Natural Models, and I'm really excited to participate with you guys today. I'll be reading the comments as they come in live, so you guys, if you have any questions or concerns, anything you've been dying to ask, you know, we get questions all the time as models and as health experts and stylists. So if you have the questions, now's the time to ask. We'll be getting them here live, and we'll be asking as many as possible to our girls and anyone that that we think should answer them. And so we're really getting excited here, and I'm going to pass it over to Katie. She's going to introduce our first guest. Thanks.
Well, a lot of what goes on at H&S is fashion, but a healthier take on fashion and how it can apply to the everyday woman and girl. So I'm so excited to announce our celebrity stylist and fashion expert, Kayla Farhang. Welcome to the show, Kayla.
Thank you very much. It's so nice being here.
So, Kayla, we've known each other for a while now,
yes.
And we were talking backstage about, we have these conversations all the time.
Right.
What would made you want to join our team and really spread this message to the H&S community?
Well, for me, when I first started working as a stylist, I one of the very first shows I worked on was a show called She's Got the Look, and it was for women over the age of 30 who wanted to be models. So it was my first experience working with, quote unquote, everyday women. I mean, the woman who won the show was a bus driver, and she was just stunning and full of spirit and life and just glowing and beautiful. And then after that show, I started getting more and more in the world of celebrity and working with a much more superficial world. And then that brought me back to How Do I Look, where again, I was making over everyday women. And I realized by changing someone's outfit, which seems so superficial, you could really change their confidence. You could change their entire outlook on life. I still get letters from women saying, I got a new job. I finally left that bad boyfriend. My kids look at me differently, you know? And so I wanted to join this team because it's so easy to write it off as, well, fashion is stupid. But if you dress and feel good, and I know you have those days like that when you walk up the door and it's like, I love your hair. I love your this. I love this. And you just, like, your head's held high and you feel good about yourself. So I just want to help girls out there feel better about themselves and their body type.
Awesome. Okay, so we had talked before, too, about your sister. So you and your sister are very different body types.
Yes.
So let's talk a little bit about that. Like, having, being around someone that you love dearly who doesn't fit this ideal of super tall and thin.
Yeah.
How did that affect her, and how did you feel watching her not feel like she could be a part of what's considered beautiful?
You know, it's hard because it's just, right? We grew up same parents, same everything, same nutrition, and I just got, you know, my dad's side of the family, and she got the other side of the family. And so, but we were always both so healthy, and we played sports.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think when you're young, you go so long without even realizing it, and then this light switches on, and then you start sizing up your friends and everyone around you going, okay, I look different than you, and are you better than me, and I'm better than myself, you know? And luckily for us, we had such great parents that, you know, we really felt comfortable in our bodies. And, you know, and as we both grew up, like, I was so self-conscious. You know, and when you see, like, people like Tyra Banks talking about how, like, I was so ugly, and then they cut to her, like...
Oh, my gosh. Okay, we have to talk about this. Victoria's Secret or my show, when they cut to, like, I was such a dork growing up, and it shows their, like, perfect model kid pictures. I was like, I will show you a dork picture growing up. Like, that will totally blow this out of the water. Like, you do have less compassion...
Yes.
...for those kinds of things, for
yes.
sure.
Yes. And so my, literally, 2 days ago in the mail, my childhood photo, like, photo albums came in, and I saw... I mean, I was just not that. I was... I try to gain weight. I was so, I felt that people called me mosquito. People called me like, what was it? The Nightmare Before Christmas, you know?
So it goes all both ways.
Yeah, exactly. And so you're going, no, you look great. And I would have killed to have my sister's boobs. You know what I mean? I'm like, I want curves. And she's like, I want to be skinny. And I think that was the first time you really realize, you know, we all want something we don't have. She had curly hair. Yeah. I wanted curly hair. I had straight hair. She wanted, you know, and
totally. Well, I think that's like a nice balance because you do work with a lot of celebrities and we'll talk about that in a second. But I think working in the Hollywood world and in the fashion world and what's the ideal versus like the women in real life that you love, that you want to make feel good and feel beautiful. Tell us a little bit about some of the celebrities that you've worked with and gotten to style and meet and all of that in the Hollywood life.
So I work with Brooke Burke a lot, who's she's amazing. She's a mom of four. And what I love about Brooke is that she's always taking down this like fake wall we have. So she's always like tweeting and showing photos behind the things because she's like, this is what I look like in the morning, you know? Yeah. And now look here, my extensions are going in and my makeup's going on and everything like that. And yeah, really, once I started working as a wardrobe stylist, you realize, you know, those girls in the photos, if you turn them around, either the zipper's all the way done and kind of held together with safety pins or those clamps going up the back, it looks like there's an exoskeleton. And you realize it's so unattainable to be like that.
And so we shouldn't feel bad when we buy clothes online and then they don't look anything like the
picture. No, I don't know how anyone buys anything online, ever. Like, I refuse to shop in catalogs because unless I put it on my body and know that that's how it fits, otherwise, like, we should all just be walking with clamps and, like, dry, you know, like,
and a fan.
Fans.
Yeah, for sure.
Because we all need that, like, I don't have hair, but if I did, it would go
if
like
you
this.
Did, you would go like that,
yeah,
for sure.
Exactly.
Well, a lot of what we want to do is we want girls to really start talking about this kind of thing and sharing their story. And we have a few girls that sent us some really insightful stories on their body image and their experience, and I want you to take a look at this clip and see what you think.
Hi everyone, my name is Kelly Johnson and I'm 16 years old, and my self-esteem journey began when I was in fifth grade. I started to develop more quickly than my friends, and my classmates began to tease me and would just say really hurtful things. And so what I did to hinder that is to wear really oversized sweatshirts, and it didn't matter if it was 80 degrees outside, I had that sweatshirt on. That was kind of my security blanket, and I thought that if no one could see my body, no one could make fun of me. And I just had really low self-esteem, but I faked the confidence. That was really easy for me, but I would internally just be like, why can't I be like this girl, and why can't I be like that girl, and why do I look like this, and why me? And this continued until I was about a sophomore in high school, and I found Healthy's New Skinny, and I found all these beautiful girls who weren't size double zeros, but were still beautiful, and all these great role models, and I was really inspired to make a lifestyle change. I began to start eating healthy and exercising, and I began to gain confidence, love my curves, love my body, and love my uniqueness. Some advice that I would give to people who are struggling with self-esteem is to find something you're passionate about. I think that if you're passionate about something, that confidence is going to emulate in the outside. So whether you're passionate about riding or horseback riding or mountain biking or science, then love what you're passionate about, do what you're passionate about, and let that emulate. I'm passionate about helping girls with their self-esteem and girls who have similar stories to me, and I want to go to college and maybe major in counseling so I can help those girls, and that's what I'm passionate about. Another piece of advice that I would give to someone struggling with self-esteem is to find what's unique about you, whether it's your eye color, your hair color, maybe you have freckles, birthmarks, scars. Just love those things because they make you unique, and there is only one you. I just want to say thank you to everyone at Healthy is the New Skinny for putting out the image that everyone is beautiful and showing such beautiful models and giving girls confidence, and just thank you so much.
I really want to thank Kelly. I think she's so adorable. Like, I look at her, I'm like, oh, if we could get her in here for a photo shoot, it would be amazing. So what is it that you want to teach girls like Kelly who maybe aren't comfortable with their bodies, but they also don't know how to dress? So what are some things that you can teach them as we do more shows and more segments and working with H&S?
Yeah. Oh, my gosh. I mean, do we even need the show? I think she covered all the bases for us. That was awesome. Amazing. But what I heard her say, and it's what I come across so much is when people are insecure about their body, they cover it up with layers and layers, which one isn't doing your body any favors at all. So what I hope to do through this program and through our blog is show, we have girls from a size 2 to a size 16, is to show this is what you can wear for your body type that makes it look good. And if you got curves, girl, show them off, because I wish I had them sometimes, you know, and you just have to find the right clothes and really accentuate what you have. And the worst thing you could do is to cover up your body and not feel good, because no one feels good in a sweatshirt. I mean, we all feel comfortable, but no one feels beautiful. And it's just finding the clothes that work. And I think, unfortunately, for curvier girls, they can't open up a magazine and flip through the pages and see, you know, 150 pages of examples of, well, this is how I should shop because this girl has my body type. So that's what I'm hoping to do here. I want this to be a place girls could come and see girls of different shapes and size and find the right look for them.
We're so excited. I really think it's going to open up so many girls' imagination to using fashion as a tool to feel good. And that's our goal all along. So thank you for coming, Kayla. And we'll be talking to you later as well for the open panel discussion with the models. So stick around. We'll be right back with another one of our H&S experts.
I think I've always had a really unhealthy relationship with food and with my body image and self-esteem. I remember when I was quite young, looking in the mirror and being like, you're fat, like, you need to change that, like, stop eating. When I was 10 years old, I started public school. Before that, I'd been homeschooled, and the kids at school were just horrible. And they would just come up to me and be like, you're fat, like, you're ugly, you're stupid. And a couple of months later, at 10 years old, I developed an eating disorder, which I struggle with to this day. And I think it's unsettling to know that children at 10 years old are picking on weight and are picking on size. I think it's so wrong. I remember I had other people in my life, and my family even, who were encouraging my eating disorder. They would be like, are you sure you need to eat that meal? Or, you know, you should just go for a run. I remember I had someone very close to me and my family, and we would go out and we would go to McDonald's and we would binge, and then for the rest of the day we just wouldn't eat anything, and it was like we were purging what we'd eaten. And so I struggled with these eating disorders, and I struggled with my weight, and it really spiraled out of control, and I suffered from depression, and I suffered from other things that all came from my eating disorder. I think in today's society there's so much emphasis placed on how you look, and I think that's so wrong. I hope one day that I can fully recover and that I can become an advocate for healthy rather than skinny. I am a survivor of an eating disorder, and I think I'm proud to say that I've come through it and that I've been there, and I'm proud to know that my story can help others. So thank you so much. Organizations like yours do so much for people like me. Thank you. Bye.
Gabby, thank you so much for sharing your story. It takes a lot of strength and courage to do that. I know it took me a really long time, and I can't tell you how much you're speaking my language, and I know so many people are out there feeling alone, and I personally had an eating disorder. I was severely bulimic. I tried any sort of drug, diet, anything that I thought could suppress my appetite and help me lose weight, and there's a really lost place, and it took a lot of strong people and a lot of support to get to a point where I realized that there was a light at the end of the tunnel, and being healthy and having a normal relationship with my body and food and actually getting to a place where I'm really confident and love myself is a realistic option. So sharing your story, and you know, me sharing my story, and all the other wonderful women that are part of this organization, or the ones that may not be have the courage to share their story yet and are just benefiting from people like Gabby and and all the girls here that are sharing their story, it's huge. It's, you know, it's really helping other people. So you really have to be proud of yourself for that. And just as Gabby said in her video, one of our main goals here at Healthy is the New Skinny is just promoting health at the forefront. We're not trying to be a certain size. We're not trying to be a certain weight. We're trying to be the healthiest we can for our own body, for our height, for our size, for however we're naturally built. And so health is at the forefront of that. And I know I'm not sitting here saying I'm the healthiest person in the world, but I think as long as we're all striving to be our best versions of ourselves, that's the greatest thing. So we're going to introduce you to our next guest, our health expert. I'm going to throw it over to Katie.
We are so excited to have Sarah Davenport on our team as a health and fitness expert. Not only is she my first model booker ever at 17 from Washington State, she was my mom at the modeling agency and saved me so many times, but she evolved into really being passionate about fashion, about fitness and health. And so I want to introduce you to Sarah Davenport. Thanks for coming with us, Sarah. Okay, so let's start first with the modeling side of things, because how did you get to this point in the industry where you were like, okay, I need to be healthier with myself and evolving into this transition where you're like, I'm going to take steps to become this health expert and role model. So where did it all begin for you?
Well, you know, I think it's kind of been sort of a lifelong journey for me as far as wanting to be healthier and learn about things. And then as I started working more and more in the fashion industry, you know, growing up, I always, same kind of thing you hear with a lot of the girls, like really struggled with my body image and how I felt about myself and just trying to figure out like, what do I need to do to be healthy? And then as I started working in the fashion industry, one of the light bulbs that went off for me really was that I'm not built like these girls. Mm-hmm. I'm not 5'10", 5'11".
Like, and how does that make you feel to be around that all day?
Well, some days good, some days bad. Like, it was really, you know, in the beginning, it was kind of like this relief.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I literally cannot look like this.
Impossible.
It's completely impossible. Like, I am not built like it at all. And then other days, you know, it starts to warp my perception. Mm. Like, if I look at pictures of myself, because I spend all day looking at pictures of models, critiquing women's bodies, like, you know, really, that's
your
job. My
job.
Yeah. And so that's what I do. So then translate that into my personal life, and it can be really tough. Mm. You know, even though that's not how I would look at normal people that aren't models, but then when I look at myself, you know, it's just a natural tendency to be like, oh, you know,
because
shocking.
Really everyone is affected by it.
Everyone.
Every single person.
Yeah.
It's not, you know, including the models. And I think that's the thing girls don't realize is you feel so alone, but really every single image you see is altered. So it's impossible to live up to that. So I think that's such an important point that you made. So how did it go into, what was the first step for you that made you really get passionate about, I want to learn how to be healthy?
Well, it really honestly started with cooking, because that was something, you know, my parents growing up, my parents were busy, they were working, they had kids, so we ended up eating out all the time. Mm. Fast food restaurants, every night of the week, you know, it was just like, my parents didn't like to cook. So that was the first thing. Then all of a sudden, you know, go on to me being on my own, being in college, then moving out on my own, and really just not knowing how to do it at all. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, that was the first part where I was like, wait a minute, I see people cooking all the time. Like, how do you do this? Oh, I can be healthier by doing this, but I don't know how.
Right.
And so that was the first part of my journey is I went to culinary school. Mm-hmm. And then I really wanted to, from there, you know, just start to look at, wait a minute, okay, now I can cook, so I really can be responsible for what I put into my body.
Right. It's almost like once you have the knowledge, then there's, you don't have the excuse of, oh, I didn't know. Mm-hmm. But I found that interesting because from my past, too, I was kind of ashamed of myself before, like when I had lost weight, of like, oh, how could I have been so overweight? Mm. But then it's like you almost have to be forgiving of yourself in a way too, because if you don't know, you really don't know. But once you have that information, now you're responsible.
Absolutely.
To choose to live a different way.
You know, and I think it's, instead of it being sort of this daunting thing, it's also really empowering to be like, yeah, I can take care of myself. Mm-hmm. I can make choices that are healthier and that I know I'll feel better, I'll look better, you know, I'll function better in my day-to-day life. All of that comes together, you know, and that was part of it, was with me making this transition and starting to go back to school and do all of that, is that I would have to have the conversations with the girls about being too big.
Right.
Oh, you've gained weight. Oh, you're not fitting the clothes. Oh, this and that. And to be that person sitting there talking to the model and to have to go through that experience with them and not have any answers.
Right.
It's like, oh, you need to lose weight. I don't know how to do it. I don't know what to tell you. You're on your own.
Yeah.
And it was really hard for me. Like, I really look at the models that I have repped and that I do rep as, you know, they're like my kids.
Right. I know from experience. And like, I can tell you, for anybody that's watching and all of the girls in the industry, that's not common to have bookers that are like genuinely care about your well-being and make sure that you're okay, especially the young ones. So it was so nice. Like, every girl that I've met that had you as a booker is like, oh my gosh, she took care of me. And it made such a difference in our experience in the industry, where it could have been like horrible. It was just moments of of horror, but there were also those really good moments too, where you were like, hey, this is total BS. Like, don't care, don't worry about what they said. Like, you know, you actually really helped to have more of a realistic view, to try and balance the unrealistic view coming from that side.
Right.
So what would you say to the viewers at home who want to get healthy? Because I think that's what the biggest question that we got was, I want to get healthy, but I don't know where to start.
Right.
And then if you look, you showed me a picture of Barnes & Noble's where it was like a million diet books, and you're going, oh my God, I wouldn't know where to start either.
Yeah.
So what do you have to say to them that is like, this is a great place to begin, and what are you going to be showing them on H&S?
Well, like Katie said, one of the things, you know, it's so overwhelming as far as all of the diet books out there. There's this, there's that, eat this way, eat that way, don't eat this, do eat this, that really, I personally believe it's important to just like slow down, think about and start listening to your own body. Start, you know, paying attention to the little things. Okay, if I eat this, how do I feel? Do I feel good? Do I feel bad? You know, and basic things, drinking more water, you know, starting to try more fruits and vegetables, like all of those little things. It doesn't have to be some broad, like, I have to cut everything out of my diet and I can never eat this again. It's like, it doesn't have to be that extreme. So for one, be gentle with yourself. And like I said, just start paying attention, and we'll get into a lot more of it on the blog. I'm really excited to just start sharing things, but you know, and to field questions as well if there are specific things. But yeah, just pay attention to your own body and how things make you feel, and then we'll go from there. So.
Sounds awesome. Well, thank you, Sarah. And we'll have you back as well for the model discussion. And I think at H&S, you know, it's really important to care about your physical body, but also your mental and emotional self is equally as important. And so we're going to talk to our next expert that's going to fill us in on what we can do to keep our mental health in check.
Right. And Katie, I think that's so important what you said. I know personally for me, the physical aspects of the eating disorder and the crazy relationship with food and everything went away a lot earlier, years earlier than the mental aspects. You know, you can be a prisoner in your own head. So I think taking care of your mental health is just as important as your physical health. And Sarah told us some great things as far as, you know, as healthy cooking. I know that was a really big thing for me as well, as learning how to feed myself well and listening to how my body feels and paying attention to hunger rather than emotions or how I'm feeling about myself or anything like that. So I think getting to a point when you're mentally stable and you have that kind of support, be it your friends and family or getting professional help, I think that it takes a lot of courage to seek help and to ask for help. And I think that without it, a lot of us wouldn't be where we are today. And I'm grateful for everyone that's helped me through what I've been through. And so first, before we meet Mia, we're going to look at April's video that she submitted for us.
My name is April, and to start out my story, I was close to 200 pounds going into my sophomore year of high school, and I didn't feel like I was pretty at all. I thought I was probably the most ugly girl out there. And, you know, I had my friends be all positive and say I was pretty and beautiful, but, you know, I wasn't listening to them. I was looking at the magazines, and I was listening to every snide comment in the girls' locker room. Well, I finally started to get healthy, and I went all the way down to 120. But as soon as I was healthy, I just kept on losing weight and losing weight to the point I wasn't eating, and then I wasn't healthy anymore. But I finally realized after a long journey that I feel pretty, I feel gorgeous, I feel like I deserve nice things now, I feel like I can just reach the stars, and some of it is actually to do with HNS, and before they came along, I've been trying to push girls in my school to see how pretty they actually are, and then HNS came to the school, and almost everyone took to the message right away, and they loved it, and that's what girls feel like they can do now. They can touch the stars, and you know, we're all put on this earth with, you know, different sizes, shapes, and colors, but we're all beautiful no matter what. And you know, to work towards my goal of being healthy again, I got an exercise machine, I'm eating better, and you know, a lot of it to do is with Healthy is the New Skinny, because they make you feel so great about yourself. And I wish girls out there, I want you to know that you are gorgeous the way you are. You really are. You don't need to listen to those negative comments. All you need to do is listen to you and look in the mirror and see how gorgeous you are. Because it took me a long time to realize that, but now that I do, I never want to lose that feeling again. And you will get that feeling if you're struggling. I know you will. It just takes a little bit of time.
Well, that was April, one of our H&S ambassadors, who is honestly like the most kind soul on the planet. I have a special place in my heart for her because she speaks so much of what girls go through. And it's this constant battle of like, oh, I want to be healthy, but then it's extreme, and then you become unhealthy in your attempts to be healthy, and mean comments and high school and all of this stuff. So how do we keep it straight to where we can stay on track and be normal of sorts and figure out what that means for us? So I'm really happy to introduce our H&S therapist, Mia Adler-Ozare. Thank you, Mia.
Thank you so much for having me, Katie. Thank you.
We have so much to talk about with you. You're like, okay, when can we set up all of our individual sessions? So let's brief on that. Talk about why you felt connected to H&S, because we literally like went like this, like a magnet.
Of
like, oh my gosh, we needed you.
So it was instant.
Give us a little bit of your perspective on this.
I mean, for me, I feel like H&S is really the culmination of so much of my life's work, and that's on a personal level and on a professional level. And I even wrote about that in my first post on the blog, because I've dealt with my own issues, as most women and frankly men also. I know we tend, by the way, in the arena of mental health, I want to really point out that these are issues that don't just affect women and girls. These affect boys and men as well. And we need to keep that in mind, because they're all in the same boat with us. And we need to be supportive of each other with that. But you know, so I've dealt with my own issues from teenage years and up, and I have 5 daughters.
Right. You guys ready for this? Okay. Continue.
Okay, I have 9 kids all together. It's a his, mine, and ours, and it's a beautiful setup. But all together, I have 5 gorgeous daughters, and they range in age. We've got 18, 17, and almost 16, and then we have a 9 and a 3.5. And so I get to see the gamut of what they experience in terms of self-esteem, how they feel about their bodies, what they do in terms of how they feel about their bodies. And I live it, you know, in my own life personally, and then of course I see it professionally. Mm-hmm. So for me, to work with H&S is really like a dream come true, because it's taking such an important message. It's really being on the forefront and the cusp of a cultural shift and truly a revolution about how we need to think about beauty and wealth, wealthy living, right, wellness, health, all of this, and culminate and bring it together and say, you know what, let's all come together, let's all get on the same page, and let's support each other in this effort to start really feeling good in our own shoes, in our own space.
I couldn't agree more. And I think like the thing we're trying to do today, especially when we talk to the models and getting a chance to see girls, just high school girls, commenting and saying, hey, like, I feel this way, and no one's talking about it. Yeah. And when we open that door, everyone says, oh, yeah, well, you know, this person said that to me, and so I never wore shorts again, and this person called me fat, and so I wear baggy sweatshirts. And it's just this negative, negative, negative energy all the time. And I think you feel so alone, especially in high school. So I hope working with you that girls can start to realize, and as we share stories, yeah, that you're not alone. It's everybody. We all are messed up to some level because this is our culture that we live in.
That's right.
So I really wanted to talk to you to go, what are some key things that we are going to be focusing on for girls to go, where do we start? Because we don't even have a home base, yep, right now.
We're going to create that. We're going to, okay, create that together. Our whole H&S team, I think that's really like one of our primary goals under your leadership and your vision, is we're going to bring that all together. And a big part of that is, and I hear it echoed actually in everything that our experts have said, and the videos that we're seeing, and April spoke so beautifully, yeah, what a delicious young woman she is, you know, that it's about understanding that beauty, it's not an external thing. Mm-hmm. You know, I will never be half my age and a different height or a different frame or whatever. I can only be me. Right. And so I think the root of this culture that we need to create is the idea that beauty resides from within and is reflected outwards. And each of us are given skills, certain, like one of the girls mentioned, pick a feature that you love about yourself, yeah, your eyes, your hair, your skin, whatever it is, and play that up. And just to feel good in your own skin and to understand that it's so easy to get caught up in that, oh, I'm not as pretty as she is, or someone says something mean to me about some feature of mine and it brings me down for the whole day or the whole week or God knows how long. And to just try to not have to be 40 or 50 or 60 years old when we finally realize,
yeah, we can avoid that,
right,
gap,
exactly,
of time and enjoy
ourselves.
Let's not
waste that, yeah, time. Let's start feeling good from a very young age. You know, my 3-year-old already recognizes, you know, when people are different sizes and look pretty or whatever her perception of that is. It starts young.
Yeah.
So if we bring this message out now and these girls continue to write in and talk to us, yeah, and we can interact with them on the website and on Facebook, we're going to really be able to begin to shift things.
And girls, you can write Mia any questions. She's here for you. And we're so excited to have you on the team. I can't tell you, all for our personal uses, of course, but also for all the viewers at home. But I do want to bring up one important thing. We talk a lot about what would happen if girls started to see different types of bodies in the media and portrayed in a beautiful way as equals, mm-hmm, instead of this one's better than this one. And so we did partner with 17 Magazine for a body image special. And I want you guys to take a look at this video and let me know what you think. And right after, it's model talk time. So get ready, take a look at this video, and we'll be right back.
We're here with 17 Magazine and Healthy is the New Skinny to let you know you're not alone. We have struggled with eating disorders and are now serving as role models to people just like us.
My name is Meg.
Hi, I'm Maria. I'm here behind the scenes for the 17 Magazine shoot.
Hi, I'm Lindsay McHugh. I want to see what I saw here today, which was more a variety in the women in the media, different, just kind of beauty at every size. I want, models shouldn't be stick thin and sick looking. That's not healthy, and it's put out there like that's healthy and it's normal, and that's really, I think, what causes a lot of girls to become so sick and struggle. Every day I have to wake up and remind myself that healthy is my new skinny.
Part of being a role model is also, you're not perfect, so I don't pretend to be perfect. I don't pretend that my recovery is a straight road. I used to look at magazines and think that the models looked totally normal. Like, I wanted to go to fashion school, so I just ate up fashion magazines. And as I recovered, I realized that's not real.
Struggling with how I felt about my body and not liking myself started with my eating disorder and really starting to compare myself to other girls and how I felt just inside, like I just didn't like myself for who I was, so I started not liking my body, and it just kind of all went downhill from there. All I needed to hear at my lowest point was that there is a way out, no matter how hard you think it is, or that you feel like you can't get there, or it's just not meant for you, it's meant for everyone. There is a way. I want to see everybody treat each other different. Like, girls need to know that they're on the same side. They're not against each other. They should be there to help each other out. And same with guys. They shouldn't be doing stuff just for guys, because really, guys don't care and like them for who they are, not what they're trying to be.
Just how you feel. If you have ever felt this way, know that you're not alone. Choose a happy life.
I absolutely love that video. I think that's the exact message we're trying to send, and showing a variety of girls and shapes and sizes, and everybody can be a healthy size and look beautiful. So we want to do something really quick for everyone watching. We want to introduce the models, but first I want them to stand up, and I want those of you at home to take a look at these girls and try to see who is considered plus size in the fashion industry. So take a moment to make your guesses. If you're not considered plus size, go ahead and sit down. So that shows you the spectrum of size when it comes to fashion. All right, so as you can see, none of these girls are actually plus size, and that's the first thing that we always get in these debates about, and I'm sure all the models hear it all the time. If you were to say, oh, I'm a plus size model, people go, well, then what am I? And you're going, oh my God, I don't want to start this conversation. Like, I don't think you're fat, or it gets really awkward. So that's what we're going to talk about right now. We want to talk about size requirements in the fashion industry. But first, let's take a look over here at Danica and meet the models.
I'm Danica. Thanks for joining us.
What's good, everyone? My name's Meg, and I'm super stoked and excited to be here today to give you guys a little bit of insight on my life as a healthy, straight-size model.
Hi, welcome. Thanks for having us. And I'm Davina, and I'm a straight size model.
Hi, I'm Rhonda Willoughby. I'm so grateful to be here to share just the truth behind what goes on in the fashion industry. And I just love this movement of healthy as new skinny. And I'm now considered a plus size model, but I've been both straight size and plus size.
Hi everyone, I'm Lisa Visaggi. I started out as a straight size model, but now I'm a plus size model. And I'm happy with it.
Hey Lisa.
Oh, hello.
Joanne asked, what size does plus size start at?
Plus size starts at a size 6. Right now I fluctuate between like a 10 and a 12, which is pretty much average. So starts from a 6 to a 16, that's the plus size range.
And the other thing to note too, and Sarah, you can shed some light on this, it's not so much a size, because Kayla, if we go into a store, we're gonna all buy 3 different sizes. So it's more of a measurement, actually. So for straight size girls, they're usually a height of 5, you can get a 5'8", maybe, if you're like killer looking.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll go 5'8" on the low side, up to 6 feet tall even. And they want the hip measurement right now is 33 inches, which is really, really small, around the widest part of your butt with your legs together. So for plus, it's really anything over, I would say, a 35, they start to say, hey, like, you're going more into the plus size. So if you want to measure yourself to take a look of how small that actually is, most women, that's really, really unrealistic. And that's what we want to talk to some of these girls about right now.
Does anybody have something specific to say about that? I know that we've all been through a huge spectrum of all of that in our careers and going back and forth. I mean, I know I have a question here from Cecilia De Matos, and she said, what's the most frustrating comment you have gotten from a modeling agent? So I know this could go on forever, so let's get started. Who's up? Here you go.
That in my industry, you can't have a butt. and be a model. That's really frustrating for me because I got a butt and I like it. And this is my butt. And everyone? And I'm proud of it.
Meg, you were also saying that you have to clench your butt to make it look small.
Yeah, I do. When I do catalogs, when I turn around, they ask me, please, can you thrust forward for us so that my butt appears to be a couple sizes smaller. So I find that really frustrating.
Anybody else had experiences like that? I'm sure you have. Let's just pass it around.
It's a short story, but one of the first bookers I had with Elite was a lady that was maybe 500 pounds, okay? And she's talking to me about eating healthy and about being healthy and being skinny and how I needed to lose weight. And I'm thinking, I'm sorry, it's just very tough for me to take this advice from you when you yourself clearly eating French fries in front of me and are far from healthy. So it's very tough to listen to things like that from someone who's the opposite.
And Rhonda, what did you have to say?
Yeah, I mean, I have many, but one of my first memories is I started modeling when I was about 13, but at 17 I was in Italy with an agency, and I was definitely much smaller than I am now. And my booker, you know, looked me straight in the eye and said, you know, if you don't really watch it now, you're going to become a big fat lady. You really need to, you know, eat healthier and, you know, more these specific ways she was telling me to eat, which, you know, I know a lot about health now. And even what she was encouraging me to do was not healthy. And the same agents would send me for massages on my legs to try to get them to be smaller. And I was signing up. I wanted a massage. But, it, you know, just the insanity of it. It's just, you know, it's They come up with some really strange recommendations because it's, you know, they want you to be like this really unrealistic size. So,
well, and to that, I think let's talk to Sarah, because we've got two sides here, which is really interesting to come from a model booker side, because a lot of people don't realize, like, you're the middleman. So let's relay that message. And obviously there's certain ways of saying things, and let's talk a little bit about that from your perspective.
In the hot seat. Well, to address a couple of things, you know, like I said, I have to be the person that has the conversation when the model's not fitting their clothes. And I am the middleman, because if a client's saying, this girl's not fitting, I can't hire her anymore, you know, as the booker, I want the girl to get the job, so I do have to talk to them about this. And I do say to girls all the time, look, my job is not based on how I look. So I'm telling you that you need to be a smaller size because these are the parameters of the job. You know, so in respect to like someone sitting there eating French fries, I try to finish the French fries. No,
I eat them first and then
throw them away. So when I have a conversation, you're not having to smell French fries. But it is. It's a really difficult thing. And some people do it, you know, a little more tactfully and with more compassion. And others just don't, because they're like, look, this is the job. You signed up for it. You want to do it.
Like,
this is what you got to do. So, well, you know, on both sides of the coin.
And if you trace that one step back, right, because it's this whole, like, chain of how the message ends up getting to the model saying you need to lose weight, is I'm the one sitting there staring at the clothes, you know, going, gosh, is this going to possibly fit on a person, you know? And the designers make them to be, you know, I think people have this misconception when you go to a photo shoot and, you know, if a girl's a size, okay, we just, like you're going to Macy's and you just go pick out a size. The fact is, designers make samples. And those samples are what are worn on the runway. It's what's worn on photo shoots that you see in Vogue or 17 or anything like that. And so they make, there's literally like two at the most of them. Normally there's just one sample, and so you have to fit into that sample size. So you, the booker kind of becomes the bad
down.
Guy.
Yeah.
But for again, your job is to get them work, and if the work is saying you have to fit into this, then you're just passing on the message
and
that
it's
started.
Supply and demand, right?
Yeah, like,
and it's the same thing for plus size samples come in a size 14. So a lot of women say, like, well, that's not even plus size. Plus size, we want to see 18s or 20s. And you're like, well, it's the same thing. A sample size for plus is a size 14, the smallest of plus size. So we get a lot of that, which is interesting, because everyone kind of, it goes up the chain of command, and it really does fall on the client in the advertising companies. So that's an interesting fact of if a lot of you didn't realize that, that the models have no say in what size they can be. Agents have no say because their job is to book the jobs, and it's people who are paying for models deciding exactly what they want, determining what size they want people to be. So
do you want to hear how that ends up in the end?
Yeah.
No, really, it's like this is a great thread. I want you guys to pay attention to everything you're hearing from there and all the way through. So here are some statistics for you, okay? You've got between the ages of 12 and 15, the incidences of depression among girls triples, okay? By the age of 18, they say that approximately one in every five girls will have experienced a major episode of depression. Mm-hmm. And by the age of 18, approximately one in every 10 girls will have had at least one suicide attempt. You know what they attributed to? Three things in this study, in this clinical study. Number one was academic pressure. Number two was social pressure. And number three was unattainable images in the media. That's
and
how
we can
substantial
all
this
relate
is.
To that.
Yep.
And Danica, do you have some questions from some viewers?
Yeah, I have a question here, and they said, have you seen girls binge and purge on the job or do anything unhealthy to keep from getting hungry on the job? And I know personally, as a working model, the bookers usually aren't on the sets with us. They tell us where we're going, what's going on, book the jobs for us, but on set are usually the models and then the people that work with the brands. But I think probably some of us girls here can speak from that. I think we've all seen things go on that maybe go... everyone just kind of tiptoes around, doesn't mention, but Lisa, did you have something to talk about?
Well, I think the craziest thing that I've ever seen on set was when I was still dealing with my weight as a straight size model. As all of you guys know, women smoke cigarettes to suppress their appetite, drink a lot of coffee and tea to also suppress their appetite. So there's a ton of that everywhere, but I actually had a girl offer me cocaine so I wouldn't eat before a runway show. I refused. That was the craziest thing. And it's kind of funny, like when I was working as a straight size model, they would actually have little things of like, you know, maybe a little thing of cheese, crackers, some chocolate, and that was all they would give you for like an 8-10 hour day, which is ridiculous.
Hey Lisa, I think we have some before pictures of you when you were straight size. Let's show those while you're talking so you can see the difference between you at a healthy weight and when you were an unhealthy weight.
Oh, okay. Wow.
Yeah.
That's really weird to see. That's really weird to see.
Wow.
Yeah. That's definitely
so that's
really
what you looked like when these stories were taking place.
Yeah. Definitely 100%. That was an LA Fashion Week. Just, you know, I'm sorry, just reminiscing on, like, what was going on with me mentally back then and, like, how my completely state of mind is now is really just crazy to me.
And you talked to me once, too, about, like, walking up to the craft services table and it was, like, this mental game of, like,
oh my
who's
going to
touch
it was
the
like,
pizza
who's
going to
touch the food first, you know? I was like, shoot, I'm hungry, you know? I want a sandwich, you know? It's been 8 hours since I ate, you know?
What about you, Rhonda? You've gone back and forth as straight size, plus size, straight size, plus size. Tell us a little bit of what that does to you and your body image.
Yeah, I mean, it's... You know, from the very beginning, I was told you're beautiful, but you need to lose weight, you know, and this is at, you know, 13, 14 years old and put on diets. And when I was 18, I started modeling full time and, I was able to get myself down to that size, but it was never easy for me. That just wasn't my body type. And it's not now. And I've been 25 pounds lighter and 25 pounds heavier. And I really wasn't happy at either extreme because it just wasn't, you know, I wasn't allowed to be me. And I mean, you know, getting honest here, I used to, prior to jobs, I would, you know, eat very limited, and then I'd, you know, partway through the day, they'd oftentimes have some really good food, so I'd start eating, and, you know, by the end of the day, I'd be just stuffed, and it was like the two extremes, and, you know, just learning now of really coming into my body, it's like, it's just about balance, and I love what was already shared about just really listening to your body, and that's what I'm learning to do, just one day at a time.
and listening less to outside sources.
Yeah,
and it really throws you off, especially, I think, with titles in the industry. Like, so for a normal girl who's a normal, healthy size, to have someone say, hey, you'd be a great plus-size model, initially, the stigma on that as, like, a normal-sized person instantly is negative. You're like, you just called me fat, like, oh, you know, and you just have this negative reaction. And in the fashion industry, they don't look at plus size models as equal. Like, it's a very small niche, and we get to do this certain catalog work, but we don't get to do what we would be able to do if we were able to force our bodies down to that standard. And I think that's a really hard thing mentally as a model to say, oh, I could have all the success if I just force my body to where it needs to be, then I'll be successful and have what I want. So have you guys struggled with that at all, trying to go, hey, what do I need to do to just get there?
Back to when we were talking about crazy things we've seen on jobs, I too, Lisa, was fortunate enough to be in LA Fashion Week, and it was crazy. I'm sitting there, and I'm drinking my water with my mom, and watching another little 14-year-old girl with her mom, and she's dipping cotton balls in olive oil, and eating them to suppress her appetite so she wouldn't eat for 3-4 days but be able to maintain a watermelon diet. And I'm just sitting here like, man, my mom would never condone a behavior like this, or my agent wouldn't either. And I'm really fortunate enough to be in a situation where my curves are okay. And I mean, it's crazy stuff, so.
It's interesting saying that. I feel very fortunate because I came into this industry as a plus size model. I have never really known anything else, and I came to natural models, and I never have been told what size I need to be. And I recognize so strongly that that is such a privilege. But I notice within the industry, I'm coming from a completely different opposite side, where I often sometimes like, well, if I work out and I get in like a regular routine and I do eat really healthy, am I going to lose weight and not work all, you know, am I not going to work anymore? This is, you know, I model full time. This is my living. If I lose even one client, it means me getting another job or not being able to pay my rent or feed my dog that eats a lot. And,
and it's a true thing.
Absolutely.
Because that's exactly what happened to me over after losing 50 pounds. They go, oh, you're too small. And you end up wearing padding because there's a padded fat suit for a lot of plus models. People don't know either. That's why they have like skinny neck, collarbone, and it's all just in this midsection. But, you know, that is a real thing, and that's a really hard place to be, to go, this is how I make my living. The money is, like, insane. There's no other place that you're going to make that kind of money in one day. So it's almost like a reward for your negative behavior towards yourself. And it's like the further you get on either side, the more money you're going to make. So I think I totally relate to what you're saying. And you're kind of in that place now of going, I would like to just be where my body wants to be. But then you also have that fear of, well, then what am I going to do for work?
I think I'm going to have to go back to the In-N-Out Burger, which was my first job. But it's interesting to talk about that. And we had a question here. It said, like straight size modeling, what size is too big when it comes to plus size? And I thought that was really interesting because there's a cusp, and maybe one of our bookers, Sarah, if you want to talk to us a little bit about that, or Katie.
Yeah. Or Katie. Well, for us, it's the same thing, like we said. The sample size for plus is usually a 14. So you can get away with maybe being a size 16, because sometimes it depends on what size the sample is. But anything over that is too big. So for people that say like, oh, I'm a plus size model and they're full plus, it's not working as a like a professional plus size model. Like, it's 16 is really the cutoff for plus size.
Yeah, we have a ton of awesome questions coming in, so we're trying to get to all of them. This, we have one from Crazy Dance 101. Awesome. Sounds like you're being healthy and dancing a lot. It says, have you ever turned down a job for what you had to do in order to get the job? I'm assuming that's something, you know, nudity based, or something, you know, promoting something you're not interested in. So did any have you, any of you girls had to do that? Lisa?
Yeah. Tell us about it. I will tell you about it.
I actually got an opportunity to do a really cool, awesome, high fashion thing for Kanye West's blog. They wanted me and another straight size model to do straight nudity. And they would fly me to New York, the whole nine yards. And I I refused. And my agent at the time, she, you know, she kind of pushed it, but then she understood. But that was a job that I turned down. Full nudity, not okay. I mean, everything's hanging out. Not my cup of tea.
Well, let's talk about that. And I think, Sarah, you have a lot to say about this. So, I mean, in my opinion, I feel like there's artistic forms of appreciating the body and shooting it in a beautiful way. And then I also feel like there's a form of fashion porn where there's nothing different about it if it were in a different magazine. That's really what it would be used for. And especially with plus size models, it's very rare that we get the opportunity to shoot an editorial. And if we do, all your goods are going to be out, like, every time. It's never in beautiful clothes or, like, telling a story. It's very sexual. Mm-hmm. So why do you think that is, that this trend seems to be so, you know, nipples and cigarettes, really, is what we call it. We're like, oh, we're so high fashion right now. We got nipples and cigarettes happening.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know where that comes from. I don't know why... You know, in the plus size world, that's kind of the trend as far as with editorials, maybe because it's like, oh, well, we'll show, you know, big, beautiful bodies. We want the bodies instead of it being about the fashion. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. It's
what about on the straight size side? I mean, you've talked about certain photographers that shoot tons of nudes and you're like, clients, like, you know, it's a fine line of it being...
Well, from, you know, as an agent, as the booker, when I really look at, you know, when those jobs come in and we have to say, okay, am I going to submit on this job? Who do I have? Who would be comfortable with it? Is it worth it? And I really have to think long term with the girl's career. So once the pictures are out there, mm-hmm. they can actually do more damage than good. So it might be a cool picture. It might be a one-time really cool job for, you know, a celebrity or for a certain... specific thing, but then long term, a lot of clients, they don't want to have a model that has naked pictures out there. It's called a, what is it, morality clause? I'm totally drawing a blank right now. And a lot of times in the contracts, there will be that. And they will Google. They'll Google the girl. They'll find the, you know, it's like, okay, does she have naked pictures out there? Does she have anything that will, you know, taint their product?
Their image.
Yeah, their image. Then she's gone.
That's so interesting. Well, I want you guys to take a look at this video. We had the Dove commercial, and we want to talk about Photoshop. So Photoshop, it can be used as an amazing tool. I went to school for it. Or it can be used as something that's really harmful, but we kind of have lost sight of what's real and what's not real, so it's hard for anyone to know. As you can see, there's a lot that goes into producing an image, and I want to talk to our models here about Photoshop and how it's related to them. Have you guys seen some bad photoshopping of your own pictures out there? And also, do you guys find it funny that when you look at your professional pictures all the time and then you see raw images that aren't photoshopped, that you're like, whoa, who is that? I've lost it. I'm never gonna work again. Like, how does that work in your mind when it comes to, you almost lose track of what's real for yourself because of Photoshop?
Yeah, that's something I've talked to Katie a ton about. I, as a plus size model, oftentimes I'll look at my pictures and they may have either photoshopped me bigger or had padding on or something like that. And you look at it and you kind of just, I assume that's what I look like in some ways. And then there's the other spectrum where I'm going out on a Friday night, I'm feeling good, and I cannot, for the life of me, recreate how I looked on Tuesday over at the studio. And, you know, I'm a single girl on the prowl, and, you know, that can do, no, really, honestly, it can do, to not be able to live up to your own image really puts it into perspective, because nobody can live up to those images. Yeah. They're all photoshopped. They put, you know, I have my weave in right now because I am so used to it that I feel like I have no hair when I don't have it in. But between the makeup and the Photoshop and the lighting and all the professionals it takes to make one good photo, it's really, really disheartening to know that not even the girls in the photo look like that.
And then when it's you, it's even worse, because you're like, I can't live up to my... I have one picture that I'm like, did I look that good or was that photoshopped? Like, I don't even know. And then it almost makes me feel bad about my own picture. I'm like, that's how screwed up this whole thing is. I'm feeling bad looking at my best picture. So I want to talk to you guys. What about you with Photoshop and anything like that? I'd like to know what your stories are.
So in one particular Photoshop, it was a bikini shoot, and it was very harsh lighting. So I see the picture, and it was just, it caught the light in all the wrong places, on my face, on my body. It was so hideous, and you're just so disheartened, like, this cannot be me, you know? But then there's other pictures where you're like, wow, this, I look like I'm 12. Like, this is crazy, you know? And in hair, too, it's easier for me to do makeup, but it's really hard for me to do hair. So I look at this hair, I'm like, wow, this looks amazing. Like, I know I have hair to work with, but I just can't make it look like this. So I completely understand how you feel. Yeah.
Lisa, you had something?
Obviously. Well, again, back when I was a straight size model, I remember this one editorial shoot that I did, and this was when, you know, I was really struggling with, like, you know, my butt and like all that jazz. And they gave me a sample size that was size 2, and at the time it was a 4. So the stylist actually made me feel bad because she knew my size, but she still wanted to try to fit the 2, so they had to ship new pants over. So this whole time, you know, I'm sucking it in, there's muffin tops going on, you know, all that jazz, and I'm just like, oh, these photos are gonna turn out horrible, you know. And then I see the pictures, and I was like, I was not that tall, and I was not that skinny. I mean, my whole body was like this, and my muffin top was gone, and I was just like, you know, that was the first time I really realized what Photoshop could really do, because I knew I did not look like that. And still to this day, I can't live up to that photo.
Yeah, you know? That's such an interesting point that you just said, because I want to talk to you about this, Kayla. Like, yeah. From a stylist standpoint.
Well, I was just going to say, it's so funny to me, and it takes my mom, it took me a while to get used to this, because you would put something on, and I'd be like, but it doesn't fit and it doesn't look right. No, it's okay, because we'll just, you know, they're like, do this little thing. Like, we'll just like paint that off or paint this off. And I mean, I've literally had on an outfit on a girl that just does not match at all. Like, if you saw her walking down the street, you would be like, well, fire this stylist. But they literally are like, no, because we'll, the top's really going to be purple later. So we'll just change that in Photoshop. And then I'm like, this is for a catalog where you're selling clothes to women. Yeah. So Laura knows if that purple top was even close to the Photoshop purple that they chose. But people use it so easily and nonchalantly that sometimes, like, why do you even need me here then? Like, you could just shave it off and make it look, you could just paint it on, you know?
Well, Sarah, and this is what we talked about too, and I know that the girls here will agree, if you're going to Photoshop it anyway, then why not let models just be a normal size? They don't have to torture themselves, and then just retouch it however you're going to retouch it. Like, that's so interesting. They do the work anyway.
Yeah.
So, again, it comes back to, I think it's, you know, it's become this culture. Like, someone has set this as the standard, and that's just the way it is. And I think that's kind of what bringing up these shows and talking to everybody to go, wait, we have to start questioning, why is this like that and who's making these rules? And go from there. But that's one of the things that we want to talk about next, is why health is such a key part in this, and why models can be really good role models and healthy models for girls to look up to. And with health, how can health be what really heals this for everybody? So a girl's not going to look like any of our models here, or me, or any of you. Where does she start with finding a healthy weight?
Well, I think, you know, through forums like this, really starting to kind of take a look at the negative messages that are going on in her head. We were talking about this before we started tonight, as far as, you know, sometimes there's just this negative chatter all the time telling you you're ugly, you're fat, you're this, you're that. And, you know, getting to the point where if you just start listening to that a little bit and going, okay, yeah, thanks for sharing, I don't need to listen to you anymore, that's a big part of it. Mm-hmm. And then it's also about sort of changing your relationship with food. You know, so much about what we eat is because we hate ourselves. Mm-hmm. So it's about restriction. It's about, you know, a diet, a this, a that. Instead of, like, flipping that coin over and having it be about loving and nurturing yourself, and how can I really feed my body so I can do the things that I love, so I feel good, so I can, you know, have fun going dancing, so I can, you know, all of these things. And so I really think it's really a matter of flipping that perspective.
And I think it's what you said of, like, so many of us, especially in the models, judge ourselves like, oh, we were good or bad based off of what we ate. Mm-hmm. So it's like if a girl walks in and is like, oh my God, I was so bad last night. She didn't rob a bank. She had like a piece of cheesecake and it's like the end of the world. Like, so I think it's trying to make that distinction between like how you feel and who you are has nothing to do with what you eat or being good or bad. And I think being in the modeling industry and having it be an obsession, and I want you girls to talk about that, like, mm-hmm. that place, we've all been there. I cried one day because I licked frosting off a baking sheet, and I will totally admit it. I was so mad at myself. Like, I was like, I'm not going to have any of these cupcakes. And then I was, like, licking it off of the, like, the batter. It was not pretty, and that was, like, a very low point for me that now I can speak about it and not be, like, and be okay. But I think every girl has that, and it's just, like, going, okay, I never want to be that person, ever. Like, that wasn't even who I was, and for me, I never thought I could even be that person. Like, I was kind of cocky about it because I came in on the plus side of things. And I was like, I would never have these issues. And you can get sucked into it so easily. And so I want to talk to you guys, the models, to say, have you had that moment where you were like, this is just a breaking point for me? Like, I can't do this anymore. Tell us about that.
For me, my breaking point was really, I met my husband and, you know, we were talking about getting married and I was like, I want to have children one day. And it was like a perspective that, like, it's not just about what I look like. It's, you know, like, it became about health then for me, really. And, you know, my hormones and everything were out of whack. It really took its toll on my body. And, it's taken me years of recovery, to come back into balance. And thinking about being a mother, it was really, I was like, I can't do this anymore. I really can't do it. And I started to just really have compassion for myself and my body. And I just really wanted to take good care. And that's, you know, what did it for me.
Yeah, Lisa, I'd like to hear your story.
I was bulimic for a month. It was short-lived, thank you, thank God, and I just remembered myself just hysterically crying over the toilet, and I just realized I couldn't do this anymore, and luckily, 2 weeks later, I went back to South Africa, and, you know, I gained 10 pounds in 1 month, which was probably the best month of my life, was finally eating after 2 years. And, you know, I went back and my agency said, oh, you know, your eating habits are out of control. It's like, you're out of control because I feel fabulous. And that's when I met Katie, and that's when I became a plus size model. So it was definitely my breaking point was when I was literally looking at, sorry for the graphics, my throw up in the toilet and just tears down my face and just realizing that I couldn't do this to myself. And I feel like I wanted to add another point, just mentally. I'm sure a lot of you girls feel the same way, that, you know, everyone thinks that this, our lifestyle is, you know, just so extravagant and everything, but, you know, it gets really lonely because really all it is just flights and hotels and, you know, a lot of Skyping, you know. And that could really, over time, mess with your mind dealing with depression, which will also affect your eating habits. And I feel like that has to do with a lot of causing with eating disorders among models is definitely how lonely the job is.
That's such a good point, Lisa. And I think a lot of that, too, has such a strain on your relationships. Like, I've seen a lot of girls that are married really struggle with it because you have to put your job first. Like, that's your income, and you're never home. And it's not fair to your partner. And there's a lot of strain that goes into, on top of the added stress, on top of what your body's supposed to look like, on top of being by yourself and missing out on every fun family function. Like, there's a lot of stuff that goes into it. It is a career that is glamorized, but there's definitely the actual reality is not what is portrayed. So moving forward, I wanted to show you guys what we've been doing. We partnered with a company called Aché Swimwear, and we had a model search that is looking for girls exactly like what we're talking about. Healthy, beautiful, confident, all different sizes. And you can take a look at the image. I think this is the kind of thing that is gonna open doors for everybody. Because what's going to happen is designers are going to be able to see what that looks like. Because I think they're afraid of the term plus size. And I think that's what we need to do, is come up with a new term for girls that are just normal, which would be natural, would be great. So I want to know from you guys, what do you think about this? Do you think that if women are shown as models in variety and all appreciated for what they are, is that going to make a difference in our advertising and in overall body image for girls? Let's start with you, Mia. What do you think about that?
I think most certainly it will. I think at a minimum, you know, when we talk about the idea that there's this unattainable image, like, you know, you're born a certain way, a certain frame, whatever that is, maybe your weight goes up or goes down, but to a certain extent, you are what you are. You have your makeup, you know, you can never be somebody else's body. So if you begin to see something reflected back at you that said, this is beautiful, this is healthy, this is what we're looking for, this can be glamorous, whatever this is that you want to call it, it most certainly is going to start going, well, hey, I kind of look like that.
Yeah, I'm not like her, but I'm like
right,
her.
Right, exactly, awesome. Exactly. And that there's, that, you know, and this is one of the things, like, who determined what is called plus size? I mean, I think that whole paradigm needs to just go away. And we need to come up with something brand new where we can say that beauty, and this is what you're showing in your images, beauty comes in all shapes and all sizes. But it's not about swinging the pendulum.
Yeah, exactly.
I think we need to be really clear. It's not about going from, okay, well, right now the culture is super skinny, so we want to be really plus, plus, plus. Now that's going to be like the most wonderful, glamorous thing. It's about healthy. Mm-hmm. It's about that my body can be the best for my body, and hers the best for hers, and hers the best for hers. And there's room for that. There's room for everyone to get to that point where they feel, you know, healthy and great in their own being.
And I can't tell you the difference between, like, even the models here and other models that I know were at an unhealthy, really damaging place and have found a healthy place. They're alive again. Mm-hmm. And I think if you can imagine what that would do to where you got a girl who maybe is naturally smaller, maybe she's more athletic, or maybe she's naturally curvy, and she has a place where she can work and be happy and be healthy and put this positive message out there, it's like it would shift a lot in the industry. And I want to throw back to you guys, what would that have done for you as a young girl to go, hey, my body's developing and changing, so I might not fit this category anymore, but awesome, because now I'm perfect in this category, and have divisions where you can kind of always find a place where you're your healthiest. What would that have done for you as a new model?
I know from my experience that would have rocked my world. I've said before, I thought growing up, I didn't realize that people were built differently, as silly as that sounds. I just thought there were varying levels of fat, and I was at the top of it, and all my friends were at Abercrombie Kids, and I was, like, at Marshall's. And I think that if I saw people in the magazines and the media that represented me, at least to a certain extent, I wouldn't have thought that what I was so bad. I wouldn't have every photo on my wall that was covered floor to ceiling wouldn't be Gisele Bündchen, and wouldn't be all these celebrities. Kate Bosworth, the Olsen twins were my idols. And, you know, I'm not saying, you know, some people are naturally thin, and I think that's perfectly okay, but I think if we got a wider range of women out there and we were seeing different types in the media, that it would have, you know, I don't even know, you know, I don't think I would have gone through what I did. I'm glad I did, because I think it's important to tell my story, but I think that something needs to change, and this is a great step towards that, and I'm sure many of you agree with that.
And Megan, I wanted you to answer that, because you're having that problem now. Even a photographer recently said that you were fat and looked like a hot dog. So go ahead and talk about that and how...
The story?
Yeah, and just how you would feel if to go, hey, like, my I do have a butt, and that's cool, and now I can model in this division and still work and be happy, and I don't have to be unhealthy.
I would absolutely love it if I didn't have to tuck my butt in every photo shoot. I mean, my life would be easier. But recently, actually this was about maybe 6 months ago, I was at a dinner with another photographer, three photographers and another model. The model is 5'11 and a half. Her measurements are out of this world. I mean, it's natural for her, but for me, I would, sitting with her at dinner, compare myself to her as the photographers would talk and pick apart my idea of the perfect model, and from all ranges. And he took an image that another of the photographer at dinner had recently taken of me and said, oh,
She looks like a hot dog. Her skin is just like a hot dog. And I'm sitting directly in front of him, and I mean, then the waiter comes and I order the edamame instead of the coconut shrimp that I was gonna get before, and it messed with my head so much, and I was sitting there at dinner just holding back tears the entire time. As soon as I got into the car, I called my boyfriend in hysterics, and you know, to the outside world, to him, it's like, what? You're fat? Like, you were just called fat? It's like, it's mind-blowing, but in this industry, it's not, and it happens all the time, and it's crazy, and I'm glad that I can be here and share this story.
Do you have a quick question?
Yeah, I just had a real quick question from Joanne here. She said, to the straight-size models, are you right now at your natural weight, or are you eating less to maintain the ideal straight-size measurements?
All right, Davina, let's talk about that one.
I definitely am at my comfortable, healthy, natural weight. I eat a lot of what I want. I try to eat balanced and portioned, but you know, I think it's very healthy to eat several smaller meals during the day. I play beach volleyball. I've been involved in sports for a long time. So what's interesting to me is, you know, working out with a coach and working out with people, a lot of friends that are the athletic, they're really trying to maintain healthy bodies and eat protein and eat things that will sustain energy so you can stay playing active and go hiking or do whatever you do. And if that would have been supported a little bit more, appreciated from a model booker even years ago, I mean, it would have made a huge difference. Now, you know, I realize it's a business, like we had heard, but it's hard to look at it as a business and not personal when it's about you. So I understand, I realize it's a business, but for someone very young, it's difficult to see where the line is. Where
and do you feel like now that you know, you've been in the industry, like you understand it,
yeah,
you're in a different place as a woman to go, right. I know where I'm my best. And so you could take a criticism like that differently versus what you could at 13, 14, 15.
Absolutely. I mean, it's, you know, you can never make everybody happy. One person you might be great for, another might not like you, yeah. But that could be anything. It could be hair color, it could be ethnicity, it could be height, it could be anything. You know, you just don't have chemistry with that person, or you do. And it's not personal, and I'm perfectly okay with not making everyone happy. But I think when you're very young, it's really challenging to understand that. It's very tough, so.
That's awesome. We're so happy to have this conversation. We could talk about this for like a week straight. So if you guys have more questions for the models, you can ask them online and we'll make sure that they give you a direct response. And we're going to be here weekly talking about all of this stuff in more in depth. And we're going to be doing style segments with Kayla. We're going to be doing one-on-one, please help me because I'm crazy, with Mia. At least Mia and I will be at one-on-one. We're going to be working on that. And then we're going to be doing fitness and health with Sarah. So we're going to have a lot of things to work on. And, you know, we just want to get that conversation started. We want to all work as a team to inspire girls to be the best versions of themselves. And know you're not alone. None of us are perfect. None of us feel beautiful. That's the first problem. No matter how beautiful we may look, we're not finding that feeling. So we're going to work on that first, is focusing on how do we feel, not on how we look. That comes secondary, because the better we feel, the better we look. So we're learning all of that as we go. So you can check us out at healthyasthenewskinny.com, follow our experts and our fashion bloggers, and make sure you stay tuned for the following shows to come. So thank you guys so much, and I think it went great. What do you guys think?